Well, I don't know what a full-scale ground invasion is. You know, that's hard to estimate. I think they're talking about the use of 10,000 troops. I imagine most of them are very, very carefully trained, and they'll go into northern Gaza. I think you're going to provoke an enormous reaction from the Muslim world. Virtually everybody from Indonesia to Morocco is going to, you know, be extremely upset. And I think we're going to see the front against Israel in the region begin to coalesce into a real military alliance against Israel. And I think that's probably now going to include Turkey, which has always been my greatest concern, not Iran.
I want to talk to you about Iran, but you mentioned Turkey. The president of Turkey, President Erdogan, just a few hours ago gave a very incendiary address to the Turkish parliament. We've picked what we think are the most illuminating 2 minutes of it. I'm going to run it now. He's obviously speaking in Turkish, so I will be reading the English subtitles. You'll be able to see them. Everybody watching us will be able to see them, but a lot of people hear this show rather than watch it, and I want them to be able to understand what President Erdogan has said. So here we go. Israel's attacks on Gaza and those who carry them out in terms of those who support them are a situation that signify both murderousness and mental illness. We have no problem with the Israeli state, but I don't approve of its cruelty in carrying out its style like an organization instead of a state. In this picture, the tears that Western powers shed for Israel while turning a blind eye to the cruelty in Gaza is nothing but the biggest example of fraud. Hamas is not a terrorist organization, but a liberation group, a group of mujahideen that is fighting to protect its soil and its citizens. It is fighting to protect its soil and its citizens. First of all sides need to take their hands off the trigger, and a ceasefire needs to be declared at once. Both Israel's attacks on Gaza and other areas need to stop, as well as the missiles fired on Israeli soil. Direct or indirect talks for the release of hostages need to begin, and this issue needs to reach a conclusion rapidly. The Rafah border gate certainly needs to be kept open continuously for humanitarian aid. For the war not to spread, all actors need to act responsibly, and forces outside the region need to stop carrying fuel to the fire under the guise of solidarity with Israel. I call on all other countries that have wisdom and a conscience to put pressure on Netanyahu's government for the Israeli state to return to common sense. I would like to remind of the need to not continue these developments with an understanding of the cross against the crescent. Are you surprised at his bellicosity?
No, actually, I was very pleased with his restraint when he first came forward and offered to mediate. And I was hoping that Washington, if not Israel, would take it seriously and accept his offer. Now what he's done, setting aside, you know, his actual words, is he set the stage for eventual Turkish military intervention into this regional conflict. He's warning the Israelis, and he's warning us that you're playing with fire and you're going to get a full-scale war. That's the message. I hope we get it.
Are we, by putting an aircraft carrier and support vessels, one of them has 2,000 Marines in it, we understand, or on it, in the Eastern Mediterranean, and another one either in the Persian Gulf or the Red Sea, attempting to provoke people like President Erdogan and the mullahs that run the government of Iran?
No, I think we think, inaccurately, I would argue, that the presence of our offshore naval power will act as a deterrent to the Turks, to the Iranians, to others in the region that might otherwise become involved in a confrontation with Israel. It's not going to make any difference. No one ashore is going to pay much attention to what we do at sea. there's only so much that naval power can do. We have 90 jets. That means that probably 30 or 40 at any given point in time can be kept in the air, especially over northern Israel, where Hezbollah is located, because that's, I'm told, the plan to use our air power to reinforce that. Now, we have some B-52s in the region, and conceivably they could be employed. But we have to reckon with the very high probability that the S-400s, which are sitting in Syria, effectively, northern Lebanon, will be turned on, in which case the air defense capability will be substantial and we would lose aircraft. But losing aircraft is one thing. It's really setting the stage for a larger regional war that's the issue right now. And we always tend to forget the Turks have the largest army in NATO, very large air force. They don't have as many missiles and rockets in their arsenal as Iran does. But if you put Iran together with Turkey and they end up in a coalition that includes the peninsular Arabs, ultimately Egypt, even Jordan, which has, like Egypt, tried to develop and cultivate a good relationship with Israel, then, you know, the stage is set for something that I think could end up destroying the Israeli state. And that's my greatest concern. That's why I've said we've got to intervene to save Israel from itself, because Mr. Netanyahu is on the path to Armageddon.
How do we save Israel from itself? Does Joe Biden call up Bibi Netanyahu and say, you can't do this? Does Secretary of Defense Austin say to Defense Minister Gallant, we're going home because we think you're shooting yourself in the foot?
Well, the issue is this. You have, on the one hand, an understandable and entirely justified interest on the part of Israel to destroy Hamas. I don't know of anybody who disagrees with that. I certainly don't. I'm 100% behind whatever can be done to destroy Hamas.
The only person that apparently disagrees with that is President Erdogan, who thinks they're a liberation organization.
Well, a couple of days ago, he took a different position. Now, suddenly, they become holy warriors defending their ground, which I think is very scary, because that makes it very clear that he has unambiguously aligned himself now with the opponents of Israel. He had not done that before. But I think it takes a president who has the authority and the strength to tell the Israeli government, no, you cannot go into Gaza and execute the plans that you currently have. Now, we've had this before. Richard Nixon made it abundantly clear that we would not tolerate an Israeli presence on the Egyptian side of the Suez Canal. Some of you may remember that the Israelis crossed that canal and then were withdrawn back to the other side, and eventually produced a very good agreement between Egypt and Israel. And of course, you know, that's another concern. Why would you want to put that at risk right now? The Egyptians have tried very hard to work with Israel. In fact, we know that the Egyptian general in military intelligence alerted the Israelis to the possibility of this Hamas attack. At least that's the public record says that. So that's another problem. You know, if you've got a population that's enraged, and that's the case all over the Muslim world right now, certainly in Egypt, how do you, General Sisi, who's leading Egypt, suppress the tendency to say we must defend and protect our brothers in Gaza? Egypt doesn't want a war with Israel, but how do you keep them out under the circumstances? I think it's the same thing for Jordan. I mean, the king of Jordan has done the same thing, tried to cultivate a good and positive relationship with Israel. But they all say the same thing. Collective punishment does not equate to Israeli security. It destroys it. That's the problem. So you've got to have a president that calls up and simply says, we can't do that. If you insist upon this, we will withdraw our naval forces. And you are on your own. On the other hand, if you pull back, we'll reconsider what our options are, what can be done, then we'll remain and continue to support you. That's a tough thing for him to do, given the power and influence that the Israelis have in Washington, D.C.
Do you think that the...
I think it's very obviously the case. I mean, you when you look at somebody like Lindsey Graham, and there are many, many others, you can go back and look at someone like Norman Poteritz, who used to advise John McCain when he was in the Senate, and he said every morning he woke up and prayed that war had broken out and we were going to destroy Iran. I mean, there's been this obsession, this fixation with the annihilation of Iran. Now seems to be the moment that the neocons, globalists, so forth, have chosen to attack Iran. And they're in a full court press. As I think I mentioned, former Senator Joseph Lieberman has been on beating the drums for essentially the same thing, although he talked about targeted missile attacks or something, which, of course, is ridiculous. Once you go to war, you go to war. And there are no holds barred. So the notion that you're going to attack two or three targets and you don't get a full-scale war is absurd.
Is there a propaganda campaign in the West designed to push the Biden administration toward war with Iran, led by people like Senator Graham and former Senator Lieberman?
Of course. You know, but this has been ongoing. This is not new. All of these people have expressed this wish repeatedly for years. They simply think that now they have the opportunity to finally unleash it. They think they've got an administration that they can manipulate, that they can push and bully into action. And indeed, they don't really have to bully. They've got plenty of people inside the Biden cabinet that are absolutely hard over to attack Iran. And this obsession with attacking Iran obscures the other things that are going on in the region, as we've discussed. You attack Iran, that's going to do you a lot of good when you've got 250,000 Turkish troops moving through Syria to engage the Israelis on the Golan Heights. I mean, this is what nobody's thinking about. What happens when the Turkish forces at sea attack our forces at sea? And by the way, remember that we're not really moving our forces into the Eastern Mediterranean at this point because they'd be at risk of attack from a whole range of weapon systems that are ashore. So at the moment, the safest place for the carrier battle group is somewhere in the vicinity of Sicily. And that's a long flight in a jet carrying ordnance to drop on top of Hezbollah. And of course, everything hinges on Hezbollah. In other words, the assumption is, and I think it's an accurate one, that if the Israelis strike decisively into Gaza with whatever size force they develop, they're going to get a two-front war. And Hezbollah is going to take the gloves off and launch its 100+ thousand missiles and rockets into Israel. So then you're dealing with other actors: Syria, Turkey, Iran, and obviously Russia. Russia is not going to sit idly by and watch Iran be destroyed. And Russia will be disinterested in going to war with us, but certainly doesn't want a war with Israel. Russia's been very accommodating to Israeli interests, but remember the Israelis have helped in Ukraine to kill Russian troops. They provided a lot of intelligence. They've had a lot of Mossad officers in the country working with the Ukrainians. So at this point, it may be that Moscow says, look, we don't have any choice. We've got to support Iran. We can't allow it to be destroyed. We wish this did not happen, but the Americans are making it impossible to stay out. It's why I keep telling people that the best analogy for this is really 1914. Because in 1914, when the various actors on the continent decided to go to war, there was really no reason for Great Britain to involve itself in that war. And the prevailing opinion when the news came that war was going to break out inside the British cabinet, with a few exceptions, was that we should stay out. We have no reason for hostility to Germany. No German-speaking soldier had fought were shot at an English-speaking soldier in the previous 300 years. On the contrary, they were very close. So the assumption was, let's stay out. Well, all of that changed over time. We don't need to go into the reasons why over the space of 48 or 72 hours the decision was made to go into the war. But when they did, they also misread the whole thing. They thought their fleet in the North Atlantic, the greatest, most powerful fleet of battleships in the world, was going to win the war. Nobody bothered to stop and think that that's not going to make any difference at all to the advance of 1 million German troops into France.
All right, back to Israel. Is the American military prepared?
American soldiers who are already on the ground over there. You've got 1,000 in Syria. You've got probably as many in Iraq. And on top of that, you have all these American bases in Turkey. And we actually have nuclear weapons stored in Turkey. And this is something that came up in the last months of the Trump administration, and I made an argument for their removal to get them out of there as soon as possible because we didn't know what the future held. And Mr. Erdogan is like no one else who's ruled in Turkey, certainly since the fall of the Ottoman Empire. But what do we do about our bases? Inkerlik is one. There are others. We've got aircraft. We've got soldiers, airmen, sailors on the ground over there. Do they become hostages? Do the Turks take these bases over? Do they surround them? What are they? Then you've got a much larger problem than the problem you have with hostages right now inside of Gaza. There are no upsides right now to this whole business, frankly, for the United States. We'll just be dragged into something, and then we have to react. And I don't think we're prepared for that.
Do we have special forces on the ground in Gaza, and have any of them been casualties?
Well, I'm told that we do have special ops forces, and I don't think that's a surprise. We had an unfortunate photograph of American special ops soldiers being feted and celebrated in Israel, and eventually that particular photo was removed, and we managed to obscure their faces, but sure, they're there. How many? I've heard various estimates. Do we have some American casualties already? Well, we know that some of our special ops soldiers and Israeli soldiers from their presumably special ops made a joint reconnaissance into Gaza, and they ran into some very heavy fire. A lot of people were wounded. At least one person was killed. But this is the sort of thing we don't talk about, and that's one of the reasons that when you deal with special operations forces, you don't bring it up. Because if something goes wrong, you don't want anybody to know about it. If something goes right, frankly, you don't want anybody to know about it. But yes, they're there, and they're absolutely involved.
Would this have been an order only from the President of the United States that American boots be on the ground in Gaza?
Oh, yes. I mean, the president is obviously aware, and he gave permission to do this. And I'm sure that Special Operations Command was just extremely excited about the prospect of doing this. For them, this is sort of a dream opportunity. Obviously, I don't see it that way, but I'm sure that's the attitude in the Special Operations Command.
The Israelis seem to have delayed their invasion. Do you think Prime Minister Netanyahu and his military commanders are having second thoughts, or is it standard to bomb first and then enter?
No, I think they would have already gone in, except that we insisted on deploying more capabilities to the region. We're bringing over Patriot missiles, theater high altitude air defense radars and missiles, and they are going into different locations in the region, not necessarily into Israel. And they're supposed to deal with this Iranian missile threat, obviously. So they have to be there, and you're adding more. You're adding another carrier battle group that creates a task force. And once those are in place, I suspect that the plan is to send the troops into Gaza.
And how does this play, I can only imagine, in the Arab world, that Israeli troops, backed by American special ops, using American-made weapons and American ammunition, are invading Gaza and killing, whether intentional or not, innocent civilians?
Well, let's answer the second question first about innocent civilians. The truth is that when you go into that environment, it is so complex and so dirty. And I mean, when I say dirty, I'm not talking about filth. It's just hard to understand how you can go into an environment where a city has literally been turned into an imitation of Dresden in 1945, and then try to root out thousands of enemy that are armed with a whole range of different weapons, everything from shoulder-fired anti-tank missiles to large-scale mortar rounds, you know, all sorts of things, you name it. You can't pick and choose your targets carefully. You know, if you think there's someone out there that's moving, your predisposition as a soldier, Israeli, American, British, anybody, is going to open fire because you want to kill the enemy and survive. Right. And you know from experience, the best way to survive in battle is to kill the enemy before he can kill you. So that's the first part, the first answer to your question. I think the other answer to the question is it's open season on us everywhere in the Muslim world, period. There's no question about it.
Colonel, is it open season on us in the continental United States?
I think so. I think so. I think we're about to learn some hard lessons from open borders, uncontrolled immigration. Everybody forgets that the people that flew those aircraft into the buildings on 9/11, into the towers in New York, had all come to the United States legally. They'd overstayed their welcome, and they had become illegal aliens inside the United States. But nobody tracked them. And if you didn't track them, they were essentially free to go and do whatever they wanted. And we know that now. We know that they went and took flight lessons in Florida. And the only lesson they were interested in is how do you take off? Nobody cared about whether or not you landed. You would have thought somebody would have said, right, geez, kind of a red flag. Yeah. But you know, the bottom line is that's true. We're going to see it. And we know that Hezbollah and Hamas have very large presences in Mexico. Of the two, Hezbollah is much larger, better financed, better organized than the Hamas presence. But there are a lot of Sunni and Shia Muslims in Mexico. There's a very large community. We have to assume, in fact, I've been told, that they have cells inside the United States. And when they attack, we'll find out how lethal they are.
Here's Admiral Kirby, number three, Chris, stating the obvious that in war, innocent civilians die.
This is war. It is combat. It is bloody. It is ugly. And it's going to be messy. And innocent civilians are going to be hurt going forward. I wish I could tell you something different. I wish that that wasn't going to happen. But it is going to happen. And that doesn't make it right. It doesn't make it dismissible. It doesn't mean that we aren't going to still express concerns about that and do everything we can to help the Israelis do everything they can to minimize it. But that's unfortunately the nature of conflict.
Your observations and from your sources, do you believe that the Israeli military has done its best to minimize civilian casualties, or are they just carpet bombing?
Historically, the Israelis, the men that I know, have always done everything within their power to avoid killing civilians. I have never seen any evidence that an Israeli pilot or an Israeli officer has deliberately attacked a church, a mosque, a hospital. Now, perhaps that's changed, but that was my experience, and I mean that. And we do the same thing, contrary to popular belief. Do we make mistakes? Sure. You saw that during the Kosovo air campaign when we struck the Chinese embassy in Belgrade. Someone looked at the targeting information, the photographs, mixed things up, and ultimately we attacked a location that we shouldn't have. I would also say something else, though, about Admiral Kirby. I hope he has a similar explanation ready if we end up with dead Americans in malls in Minnesota, Pennsylvania, Texas, and Ohio, where Muslims could suddenly show up and gun everybody down that they see, or engage in knife attacks, which is what we've seen in Great Britain and in Europe. This is very possible. It's very plausible. I don't think the American people are going to be very happy to discover that these enemies that are killing people over in Israel or in Europe are also here inside our population.
What will it take, aside from old Joe talking to Bibi,
I don't think that there is anyone in Washington currently interested in dialing anything back. If anything, I see the opposite. There are very, very few voices urging caution. No one is saying, you know, emotions are running hot. This is not a good time to make these decisions. We need to think carefully about the consequences, look at the strategic as well as the operational implications, take seriously what the president of Turkey has just said, take seriously what we're finding out through the intelligence systems about potential attacks against us as well as Israel and in Europe. No one is doing that. So I don't see that that is possible. What I do see is an enraged American population and probably enraged European populations when they are drawn into this, when their societies who've been penetrated by the same terrorist organizations and elements fight us because we're supporting Israel. Now, that doesn't mean that we should abandon Israel. It simply means we need to think very carefully about what we can and can't do, because we still have an obligation to protect America first. We're not doing it. We're not doing it on the border. We're not doing it in our cities. We're not doing it anywhere. I would hope that
America... Is that right?
Yeah, I think we have the testimony in a public forum of a Ukrainian official essentially telling us that he was assassinated because he was part of the negotiating team back in March and April, and appeared to be, in their view, a Russian collaborator. Because, as he points out, that the team went there with no intention whatsoever of negotiating for peace. They were interested in simply dragging things out to buy time for Ukrainian forces to fight the Russians.
Well, are these rogue negotiators that are interacting with the Russian government on their own, or are these people that were dispatched by President Zelensky?
No, well, they were sent by Zelensky. And, you know, then the whole thing, as you know, was subsequently suspended in Istanbul. And they dropped the pretense of being serious about negotiating a solution. But this man was identified early on and then essentially shot and killed on the grounds that he was a Russian collaborator. Now, I don't necessarily think he was. There are a lot of people in Ukraine who have been accused of this sort of thing simply because they opened their mouths and suggested that a peaceful solution was desirable.
Have there been or has there been the resignation or the firing of late of people around President Zelensky in his cabinet and in his personal staff? And if so, what's behind that?
Well, someone who had worked in the defense ministry for Zelensky, who was in the cabinet, resigned in the middle of the allegations of corruption. Surprise, surprise. There was also an allegation that, I don't know if it was he and his family, but another cabinet member who had vacationed somewhere in the Mediterranean, or no, I guess it was actually Florida, somebody said, while the war was going on, which of course was bad form given the desperate straits that the Ukrainians face. He seems to have resigned. You had this man, Arestovich, who was the spinmeister or public affairs officer, media spokesman, defense ministry employee, who suddenly up and resigned and then subsequently spoke and said he doubted seriously that the Ukrainians could ever win this war with Russia and wondered whether or not it might actually survive the war. And then suddenly he, surprise, surprise, was blocked. And nothing further has been heard from him, though as far as we know, he has not yet been killed.
I would imagine he has a big target on his back, a former government spokesman who resigns and says we're going to lose.
I think it's probably a good thing he takes the heat off the rest of us who are on the death list.
I know they're after you, Colonel, because I've seen that stuff. I haven't gotten word that they're after me, but I trust if you hear that, you'll give me a heads up.
Well, if I'm still around, I will. Absolutely. If I suddenly disappear, you don't need any further confirmation.
All right, let's talk about the wish of President Zelensky and his military commander for tanks and the absurd footsie that the Americans seem to be playing with the Germans over the tanks. Everybody wants these German tanks, and Joe Biden's getting in the middle of it. Do they know what the hell they're doing?
Well, I think it's pretty clear they don't. In fact, I think this is an important theme that we should address, because the mood in Washington has very definitely changed. The attitude of the Washington community, and that I'm talking about those people that are the leading senators, members of the House, cabinet officers, president, vice president, the mood of these people has clearly changed. I think they're sensing that this is a lost cause, that Ukraine is very definitely going to lose. And they're trying to figure out, how do we prolong the suffering? How do we prolong this fighting? They'll say publicly it's for the purpose of, quote unquote, harming Russia, which has been a complete fiasco and a disaster, because Russia, frankly, has not been harmed very much. Not at all, I would say, in substantive terms, economically, financially, otherwise. But I think that's part of it. The second thing is that they're now really goading the Europeans, the Germans in particular, into committing acts that, frankly, can be regarded legally anywhere in the world as acts of war against Russia. And I think the German government is sitting there saying, you know, do we really want to supply heavy military equipment, tanks, artillery, all these things in great quantities to this war zone to help these Ukrainians fight the Russians? Are we not, in fact, becoming co-belligerents? Now, you and I have talked before about this.
Yes.
I don't think there's any doubt about it. We are co-belligerents, but I think the Germans are now interested in putting the brakes on that. So Scholz put us in a difficult position because his representative at Ramstein last week at the conference for donors and allies that were willing to send things to Russia said that the only way the Germans would send any tanks, Leopard tanks, was if we sent M1s. Then we went through a series of comments from people in the Department of Defense, like this Mr. Colin Call, Assistant Secretary of Defense in OSD, who said, well, you know, the M1 is a gas guzzler, and it has extreme maintenance requirements. It's too complex for the Ukrainians. It won't help them. The Leopard's easier for them to use, and the Leopard would be better.
Now, you have agreed with that, haven't you?
Oh, well, I agree with it, but not for the reasons that Mr. Call said. I mean, we've known for 30 years that the gas turbine engine's a catastrophe, both for reasons of fuel usage, but also because of the intake of all the dirt and sand and nonsense on the ground. This is an engine designed for the use of a jet at 15,000 feet, not for use on the ground. So here we have this turbine engine that's supposed to power this tank up and send it at 50 or 60 miles an hour towards the enemy. The problem is that historically, that's not necessarily what you need from the tank. I mean, tank doesn't have to go 50 or 60 miles an hour. We don't need to cover all that ground again, but the bottom line is that the M1's got a lot of problems. There's no question about it. I don't think people wanted to see this employed for the fear that they would be embarrassed by its performance. Not the gun, not the crew, but the tank as a whole for the reasons we mentioned. So now the tables have turned. In order to get the Germans to send tanks, apparently President Biden said, well, we'll send 10 M1s. And Mr. Scholz responded by saying, well, fine, then we'll send 10 Leopards. Now, this seems childish and stupid, but I think we need to understand what's really happening. Number one, people have no faith in Ukraine's ability to win this war. We have been lying about what's happening in Ukraine between the Russian and Ukrainian forces for months. We have been exaggerating Russian losses, exaggerating Russian problems, and minimizing and obviating Ukrainian problems and losses. The truth is seeping out. You can't conceal it much longer. So the first thing is they know they can't win. In other words, we're losing the proxy war. Our proxy can't win it. Secondly, the Europeans are concluding that this is dangerous. You know, how far out do we stick our necks? And they don't have the military industrial power to rapidly produce anything. And I think this is enormously important. The lead time, for instance, for the AMRAAM missile, which is a very important weapon that's used in the F-15, the F-22, the F-35, and by NASAMS, this, brilliant, what I would call it, brilliant air defense system that we and the Norwegians have put together with Kongsberg. It's excellent for shooting down cruise missiles, helicopters, so forth. The problem is that from the moment you ask for a missile, the wait time until you get it is 32 months.
Oh.
That's how long it takes to produce these things. When you look at all of the missiles that we're promising the Ukrainians and the systems, they're not going to arrive in any short period of time. Now, the Germans are talking about giving the Ukrainians air defense systems like the Patriot, and they'll probably provide them with some missiles. But you'll go through those missiles very rapidly, and you just can't replace them. So the Europeans and we do not have the surge capacity to fight a major war. We just don't have it. The Russians do. Their factories are operating 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Contrary to popular belief, they're not running out of anything. They've got more of what they need than they've ever had. So all of this is dangerous. That's what we're learning from the Europeans now in private.
You stated at the outset of this last statement you made that you have sensed from public sources and I guess from the people with whom you communicate regularly, a change in attitude on the part of decision makers in Washington. Now, I would imagine that what you have sensed is below the radar and it hasn't yet bubbled up into the public consciousness.
No.
I mean, maybe Joe Biden's a bad example, but a hawk like Lindsey Graham, you're not going to hear him saying tomorrow the Russians are going to win and we ought to get the hell out of there, even though he may be whispering that to your friends and colleagues in D.C.
Well, see, that's an important point because I don't think they're whispering that. See, this is the great danger that we face right now. A couple of historians contacted me and they insisted they talk to me. And they walked me through all of the things that FDR did as president in the 1930s to effectively goad the Japanese into attacking our forces in the Pacific.
Right.
And we all knew, I mean, contrary to popular belief, the Navy, the Army, Marshall, the CNO of the Navy, Stark, all these people knew that the Japanese could, in fact, attack and destroy Pearl Harbor. And in the run-up to the war, FDR did several things. He put out something called the McCollum Memorandum and directed the Navy to deliberately violate Japanese home waters.
Yes.
And they did it with warships again and again and again. And he was told by the CNO, you know, we could lose some ships. He said two or three ships is okay if we have to lose that. I mean, this is incomprehensible today, but that's what he said. And ultimately, they told him what the implications were, and he said, continue to do it. Ultimately, we know what happens. He leaves the fleet deliberately in 1941 in June in Pearl Harbor. He does not return the fleet to San Diego and San Francisco, where normally in Puget Sound, that's where the fleet in the Pacific was quartered, not in Hawaii. And the CNO said, Mr. Roosevelt, you know, Mr. President, we're targets.
We're sitting ducks.
We could lose the fleet. Ultimately, you know the rest of the story. He deliberately did this. There are a lot of other things. He was sending as many bombers as he could to China to Claire Chennault and the Flying Tigers at the time. He wanted to build up an air force there that could firebomb Japan from China. This is in 1939, 40, 41. We don't talk about any of these things. And what they said is what is happening right now looks an awful lot like what FDR did. Now, I personally don't think that that's on President Biden's mind. But then again, I'm not sure President Biden is much more than the man who reads the script that's handed to him.
All right, let's
I don't know what the people behind him are up to, but if you look at what we're pushing, this is what brings you to the next point. Ukrainians are going to face this onslaught. They have already said they can't withstand it. They're going to collapse. It's already beginning, and the Russians haven't even attacked in strength. What do we do then? Do we play this game of Polish forces, American forces, Romanian forces, whatever else we can get, and push some distance into Western Ukraine? Do we then play the confrontation?
I want to play the Russian side of this from Foreign Minister Lavrov 2 days ago in South Africa. Gary?
Мы говорим о том, что там происходит на Украине. Мы говорим о том, что это война, она уже почти не гибридная, а почти настоящая, которую Запад долго готовил против России, стремясь уничтожить все русское от языка до культуры, что было на Украине столетиями, и запрещая людям говорить на...
Fair to say that he's speaking what President Putin thinks.
Yes.
Okay.
And I think not just President Putin, I think the majority of Russians. And it's a fair assessment based upon the things that we've been seeing over the last several years, unfortunately.
But this is a direct accusation by the internationally recognized foreign minister of Russia, pointing a finger at Washington, D.C. and the West as the prime motivators for this war. And then he uses this odd phrase, which you and I have discussed off air. He said, it's not a hybrid war, it's a war. What does he mean by hybrid war? What does this phrase mean?
This particular term was coined or invented by a former Marine major named Frank Hoffman. Very nice fellow. And I think it was really designed to somehow or another give the Marines a justification for lots of Marine infantrymen to fight in future insurgencies. And what he was trying to talk about was, today hybrid war consists of men with rifles on the ground, media, external factors, other players in the international arena, game-changing weapons, all of this, instead of what we normally think of war as a more conventional confrontation with armies and air forces and so forth. And what Lavrov said, let's throw this hybrid nonsense out. We're talking about a real war. He's talking about high-end conventional warfare. He's not talking about nuclear warfare, but high-end conventional warfare. That's everything up to, but not including, nuclear weapons. And he's saying this is being planned against us. That's a fair conclusion on his part, based upon what you see us doing, trying desperately to provide enough support to the Ukrainians. Remember, our support goes beyond technology, goes beyond weapon systems and ammunition. It's information warfare. You know, we control the information highways. We are proselytizing for war against Russia. We are depicting Russia as this evil state, this nationalist state that rests on the foundation of Russian Orthodox Christianity. It protects its borders. It has an identity. Ergo, it must be destroyed. It must become like Western Europe and the United States, a country without borders, a country with identities that are being washed away in seas of illegal human trafficking, drug abuse, and so forth. That's what's at stake in their minds, and it's not an unreasonable assumption based upon what we're seeing. And he's saying, look, we're going to fight. And that's what we need to understand. They're not kidding, and we're not prepared for an all-out war. But are Russia the people is.
Are the people in Washington who now are manifesting a change in mind, aware of the defiance and forcefulness with which these kinds of statements out of the mouth of Mr. Lavrov have been made? And are they prepared to counter it by sitting down and talking to him? Do they think they're going to counter it militarily? And do they not realize that that's World War III if they do?
Well, first of all, I think it's very clear that under no circumstances are they going to hold talks with the Russians, because that would suggest that they've made a mistake.
Right. It would suggest that we're pulling the Zelensky strings, which of course we are.
Yeah. So it's not, I don't see us doing that. You know, I was asked the other day by a journalist, what do you think we should do? I said, hold talks immediately without preconditions. We need to come to some sort of resolution no matter what. That in fact, was essentially what Kissinger said a few months ago, and then, of course, changed his tune. We're not going to do that. That's an admission of failure. No one in Washington ever admits that they failed at anything. Everything's a success, no matter how many times you fail. That's the first problem. I think the second problem is there's a lot of arrogance and self-delusion. I don't think the people on the Hill really understand what war means anymore. For many, many years, we had lots of interesting people on the Hill. Sam Nunn was a good example, but there were many others. Most of them had served in the military. A lot of them lived through the Second World War. They understood what you meant when you started talking about war. So when it came to Russia, or in those days, the Soviet Union, people made it very clear, that's not what we want. Whatever we do, we must find a way around that, because we all know what that means. And they weren't necessarily saying it would be nuclear, but it would be so destructive and self-defeating, we don't want to engage in it. I don't sense that anymore.
What are the, what is your understanding of the latest numbers of military killed? Ukraine, Russia.
Well, Judge, first of all, this goes back to the fiction that we've been spinning about the war. We haven't told the truth about Ukrainian losses. It's becoming harder and harder to accept. We know from obituaries, we know from people on the ground in the hospitals treating the wounded, we know from the Ukrainians themselves who are posting things, comments on Telegram and sending videos. Ukrainians have lost easily 122,000, with absolute certainty, men killed on the battlefield. Secondly, they've admitted to roughly 35,000 missing in action, presumed dead. I mean, if you go back to World War II and you look at German fatalities, there were almost 2 million casualties or dead, frankly, from the Second World War in Eastern Europe and the German Wehrmacht. And a substantial chunk of that, hundreds of thousands, were missing in action, presumed dead. They were never recovered. We have to understand that the majority of casualties being inflicted on the Ukrainians is a consequence of artillery fire, not just hard shell artillery, rocket fire, firing thermobaric warheads. These are the fuel air explosives that utterly destroy a whole area. This is how you avoid going into buildings where there may be people waiting for you. You fire a thermobaric warhead into the building, it eliminates the oxygen. It's destructive, but it kills everything because there's nothing to breathe. You have a whole range of these kinds of explosives. The Russians have great quantities of them. They use them very effectively because they are also linking these in real time to overhead surveillance. This is surveillance, reconnaissance, intelligence platforms. So you're getting within seconds sometimes, certainly within a minute or two, accurate data to the artillery systems that can then fire. Keep in mind that the Russians can fire up to roughly 60,000 rounds a day.
Mm.
Ukrainians are lucky to get off 6,000 or 7,000 rounds a day. In other words, tenfold more than the Ukrainians can fire in response.
Can you address the... You've indicated 122,000 dead, 35,000 unaccounted for, probably dead Ukrainian. What do your sources tell you is the number of dead or missing and unaccounted for on the Russian side?
What we're getting from the Russians, as well as from some the Ukrainian sources, are just, unfortunately, when it comes to the Russians, they're just not believable. But we are hearing from people on the battlefield, depending upon where you are and who you talk to. The Russians have had somewhere between 16,000, 17,000 and 25,000 killed, and perhaps another 25, 30, 40,000 wounded. And people say, well, how could that be? I just explained it to you. You have overmatch in firepower on a dramatic scale, on a strategic scale. That's why.
When will the globalists in Western Europe and in the State Department and the Defense Department come to the same realization that the political class has in Washington has begun to achieve, that this is a losing fight and we have to change the mission?
Thus far, I haven't seen any evidence that there's any recognition of this. In fact, I continue to hear these disturbing comments that, well, if the Ukrainians have to fall back to the Polish border, then we'll fight a perpetual war against the Russians.
So this crazy president of Poland is going to send 100,000 Polish troops east over the border and is going to beg Joe Biden to let the 101st Airborne join them?
Well, I don't think he has to beg. I think there are lots of people that would push for that. And remember, you've got at least the equivalent of three armor brigades from the United States on the ground in Poland and down in Romania, plus the 101st, plus other units, formations, artillery, and so forth. Then you have the Poles, as you point out. They've now mobilized at least 200,000. They're trying to build up a force of over 300,000. That would probably support the projection of somewhere between 60 and 100,000 troops on the ground. I don't know about the Romanian side, but I know that there are elections scheduled in Poland for the fall. I don't know exactly how the government thinks, but the Polish population, you know, and this is very important. We also discussed this map of Europe that shows the various polling data. And what you get all across Europe from the publics is a very definite preference for a negotiated solution to this war as soon as possible. There is no evidence that anybody in Europe wants to go to war with Russia. And I'm beginning to see that happen in Poland, where more and more Poles are saying, wait a minute, you know, we're literally on the edge of the abyss here. If this war spreads, we will be destroyed.
Doesn't the German public want inexpensive Russian natural gas back in their homes to heat them for the winter?
I'm sure some do, but not yet. I think there's this belief that somehow or another they can get past this tough winter and be ready next year with their alternative energy sources. This climate change business is more than a program. It's a religious faith. in much of Europe, and particularly with the Germans and Scandinavians. It's quite strange. And real data don't make any difference anymore. Again, everything connected with this war is emotion.
All right. I'm going to assume, or I want you to assume, that everything you've just educated us on is known by Russian intel and is known by President Putin. Does he come in with this slam bang invasion of 300,000 to 500,000 soldiers and finish everything off, or does he let the Ukrainians just sort of die on the vine?
I think he knows that he can't do the latter, because we will constantly try to resuscitate the corpse, no matter how bad it gets. We will rush in there, put it back on life support, try to get it back up on its feet and fight. I think he knows that the only way to rid Ukraine of this Ukrainian armed force is to go in and destroy it, and ultimately to replace this regime with something else, or wait for something else to emerge. I don't think he feels anymore, or for that matter, any of the Russians, they can trust anything we say. They know they can no longer trust the Europeans. They used to trust the Germans, and they actually, I think, believed Macron at one point in time. Now they know they can't trust anybody. I don't see great enthusiasm for a long and destructive war in Ukraine. Why would they be enthusiastic about that? Why do they want to kill other Slavic Orthodox Christians? I don't think they do. But the point is, they don't have much choice. And I think they will press ahead. The question is when. And I told you I thought that the major offensives would begin sometime between the 21st of January and the 7th of February. We'll see if I'm right. There are others that say, oh, no, they're going to wait until March. I don't know. But I think it's coming sooner rather than later because of the things that you're pointing out. You know, why should they sit around and wait for resuscitation again? Why not just go in and put this thing out of its misery? But it's not going to be a lightning blitzkrieg. That's all nonsense. Warfare has changed. They have over Ukraine this large umbrella of intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance assets, and then they have this wide range of strike assets, everything from rocket artillery to jets to tactical ballistic missiles to long-range artillery. All of this is linked, and they're going to move their ground forces under this umbrella. They're not going to be surprised. Anything out there that looks like it could threaten their forces will be identified and struck quickly and put out of business as they move. So instead of this lightning blitzkrieg, it'll be a deliberate, methodical advance. It'll take a little longer, maybe a month, maybe 6 weeks, but it'll happen.
I know your field is military and not intel, but you have friends across the board. How long does it take the CIA to tell Joe Biden what you've just told everybody watching this show?
My experience with the CIA is not great, but from what I do know about intelligence officers and analysts is that there's always someone there telling the truth. That's not the problem. It's the decision at the top as
Correct.
To what
is
kind of intelligence they want.
Is the truth making its way through upper management and into the Oval Office? Probably not. Those people that go to the Oval Office are going to tell old Joe what they think he wants to hear.
Well, a good barometer for that is Mr. Burns, the director of the CIA, who was formerly the ambassador in Russia. And he's
a serious, credible guy or a political hack?
Well, I mean, that's I can't answer that question, but he did write the memo that says "Niet" means no. In other words, no to NATO expansion, and outlined the implications for pushing the expansion of NATO to Russia's borders. He didn't say anything that George Kennan hadn't already said. And I don't think he said anything that people like Chaz Freeman haven't also pointed out, and Ambassador Matloff and others. But he's a member of the administration. He's on the team. And in Washington, if you want to be on the team, you sing the tune. And I've watched this at very high levels, certainly for the last 10 years of my military career. And I was often deeply troubled by the rapidity with which people told people lies. They just didn't tell the truth. They spun the fiction because that's what was desired. We went through that in Iraq and in Afghanistan, the same thing.
Sure. Colonel, such an education and so much appreciation from the text messages that are coming through. We very much appreciate